has to be a donut.
Why is there a time limit on this?
There shouldn't be.
Well, there is.
I was going to say, do you want me to play a bit? But it didn't last time, did it?
No.
Is it because we've got the ones on still? I think
that's what I'm thinking.
We need to undo this. Or just
no,
I don't know what I'm doing.
I want you to turn it on.
Hang on.
Now I have to put it back on, you meant to.
Well, you know that, anyway.
Oh, excuse me.
Give me a shout when you're ready, Kayla.
Okay.
You literally have to shout it.
This is our first real one.
So we've done. Man, I didn't know that for all the pressure now. It's the first real one.
You can meet James and Esther if you like. So, this is James and Esther.
Hi, James.
How are you?
Hi, Esther.
Hello.
They're obviously from my church.
Yes.
And we did.
Isn't it obvious? You can dress a certain way. Obvious. You must dress a certain way. Yeah, I think I'd be like,
so, ready?
I think so. Can you sit there just so I can angle this and everything?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going to keep my eye on this thing so I have no idea what it's going to do. It might blow up for all I know.
That'd be exciting.
It would be exciting if my work's phone blew up. I'm not sure I'll be very happy.
I would be.
I'll have to give you another one. It just exploded.
Yeah. What happened? Well, I was doing my podcast.
What do you mean, your podcast? I mean, I was.
I was trying to delete the file. What file? All the pictures. What pictures? The ones I took of Swep.
Okay, so before we start off,
check my lights.
I'm going to try this. Tell me if it's too much. Exactly, hey. Like you have to do that. It's too much.
Did you say Dave?
Did
you
blow the RCD when it went?
No, nothing blew.
No.
No, we didn't.
You normally do.
Yeah, no, we didn't reset anything.
This might blow.
I'm scared now. Now we said that.
No, no, he's talking about the yours.
To be fair, I've never used these more than 5 minutes, so.
That's alright. They're made for. Oh, that's alright.
Is that
it's
too
quite
much?
Pleasant, actually.
Yeah.
It feels like it's daytime.
I was expecting a lot brighter and nastier than that.
But if you haven't used them in
they're very warm, unfortunately.
That's alright. I guess that's why I put shorts and a t-shirt
on. What's happened to you?
You haven't used them for longer than 5 minutes.
Not really, no.
Well, if it all catches on fire.
At least we'll be toasty on this icy night.
Yeah.
I will swap between glasses.
Why?
So that I can read things. If I leave my reading glasses on for too long, chatting just normally, I start getting headaches and that.
Yeah,
if I'm using them to read and be on the computer, they're fine.
Yeah.
But the moment I sit here and I'm looking around, I can't see properly then. I have to wear my normal glasses.
You didn't fancy bifocals?
That's too expensive for my prescription.
Also, my dad has them, but he's like hates them, never wears them. He's like, one, and it's just, it just makes him feel really queasy.
Hang on, do we have to clap?
You do have to clap.
We have to clap. No, I have to do one clap.
Exactly what she did.
Like that, one clap. You should know one clap.
It's just, I thought it was funny.
And you, please.
I have to do a clap.
One clap, just
one.
There we go.
Amazing.
Yeah, so I can sync it up later. It helps.
So, welcome Esther.
Hi.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Esther.
Esther.
What do you want to know?
So,
I'm better with like facts and questions.
Okay, so
what do you want?
Are you, when did you become a Christian?
Right.
How long have you been a Christian?
Right.
When do you think that you've had salvation? Did you grow up a Christian? Is it something that happened in your later life? That sort of thing. So, just them little bits.
So I grew up in a Christian family, so I did say I've always been a Christian.
I don't really remember when I was saved specifically.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it was I was young. I went to holiday clubs as a kid. I remember being one of the younger groups, and like they were talking about like knowing Jesus as your friend and like having your own relationship, and I was like, okay then. So I don't remember a specific point because I've kind of always been there, always been a constant. But definitely as I got older, I started to realise there's more to it than just, you know, a guy in the sky. You know, you can actually have a relationship with Jesus and you can know him more personally and all those things. But yes, I want to say my whole life if that's possible, because I feel like it probably is. And Christian parents and everything, Christian family, have been in church my whole life. So yeah, I'd say always grow.
Yeah, so a sort of natural to some extent. You've grown naturally in a Christian household and that sort of thing. So obviously on camera, they're not going to tell that you don't speak properly anymore. You're not from the black country anymore, and you do not have that black country accent.
No, because I speak really well.
So
unless I'm
you
tired.
Don't want to tell everybody I call spike proper. Oh yeah.
No, I can.
Yeah.
Stop, because it might come out. It might happen. Dave, because it's so strong around you. No, it tends to happen more when I'm tired or grumpy or angry. The black country comes out, being from Wolverhampton it does, but I trained myself so well to speak correctly. And be articulate, because it sounds a lot nicer.
So there'll be some people thinking, black country, that's a bit of a strange thing to be saying. Do you think you're allowed to say that? Do you want to explain to listeners what the black country is?
I'd love to, Dave, but I couldn't tell you.
Okay, so let me teach you what the black country is.
Please do.
So in the Industrial Revolution...
Food, like, suck, right? And everything kept getting
there
black.
There you go, you've got it.
The chimneys or the smoke or something.
So Industrial Revolution, when we're burning all the coal...
Yeah.
At night, all that dust would settle back on the...
See, I know something.
Yeah, it would settle back on the city or the towns or the villages, and then wake up in the morning, and it was like a black snow. So it became...
I know that. My knowledge mainly ranges from Disney to Disney. So, generally, you know, history and knowledge isn't my thing.
Yeah, so...
I did remember itch about
it
that.
It became the black country for that reason. So, and for those of you that don't know, the black country is not Birmingham, and Birmingham is not the black country. And if you listen to the accents, you will tell. Now, I have a little bit of a stranger accent, because I'm from Birmingham, grew up and spent a lot of time in the black country, being a West Bromwich Albion fan. Please don't turn off because of that reason. Some of you may hate me because of it, especially Villa fans and Wolves fans especially. But yeah, so I have a bit of both in me, and I can talk, and I have to say, I love the black country accent. Absolutely love it.
It's certainly
and
a good, quiet taste.
And a good Brummie would tell you, it's Boston. And we won't talk to you about the faggots and pays yet and the black country scratchings. But we'll leave that for another time.
No, I'm really not from there.
So to be fair, Esther, I've gone through your playlist, and your playlist is you.
Right?
It really is you.
I really tried.
It really is you. And I've gone through it and I think, yep, Esther, I might not have picked the exact songs, but I would have gone around the kind of same area, and it does show all your personality and who you are. And obviously, if you don't know how these podcasts works, it is you give me songs, I put them in our random order, and we talk around about them.
Let's do it.
So, let's go for our first one. Let me find your playlist on Spotify. It's already made, but you're not getting it until this comes out. Which, obviously, if you're watching this now, it's come out. That's a stupid thing for me to say. I'm sacked.
Yeah,
I'm just going to speak to my editor. I'm sacked.
Yeah. I'll sack you then on after the talking.
Let me just make sure I've got the volume up. No, I haven't. Let's get that volume up.
There's some real good tunes on here. I mean, I would say that.
I haven't listened to them yet. I don't know what's coming. Not properly.
So,
I just glimpses.
I was going to do this one as the last one, but I think we've got to go first.
Oh, just from that, I just can't. Honestly. I'm like, bro. Just I just see a different part of my life in this song. Never actually listened to the full song. Because it's never played. So what am I like?
So if anybody doesn't know that song, even I know that song. I didn't know the name of the song or who sang it, but as soon as I put, within 1 second, oh, it's that one.
Yeah.
So everybody knows it, obviously a thing from Friends.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming Friends is probably your favourite ever sitcom you've ever seen in your entire life.
100%. I can't honestly explain. I watched it when I was really young, I was probably like 13. But I remember seeing it on E4 one Saturday morning, and I was watching the TV and I was by myself, and I put it on, and I just thought, I was kind of that weird age when you're like trying to be grown up, but you're not allowed to be yet, because you're still like, you know, young. And I saw it and I was like, oh my gosh, this is so funny, my parents will probably disapprove. But then I was like, oh, it's just so funny, I can't not watch it. And then I told my mum, because I felt so bad, I was like, mum, I've watched this program, and she was like, okay. And I was like, it's called Friends. She's like, oh my gosh, like, I grew up watching Friends, like on a Friday night, me and dad and our housemaid Dave would sit and watch it, and I was like, so I can keep watching it? She's like, yeah, of course, we love it. Now I watch it as an adult, I'm like, oh goodness, because a lot of the jokes went over my head.
But, yeah.
I don't know what it was about it, it was just so fun, and I really struggled with Friends growing up, actually. So I think it was one of those things I would come home, it's such a comfort, because they're friends, and they almost become your friends, which sounds super sad. We're okay now, everyone, it's fine. But at the time, it was just, I wanted to come home and watch Friends, and actually my parents bought me the box set one Christmas. I don't think I did anything else. I watched that box set, 10 seasons, like, so many episodes, like 300 episodes or something. And I watched them pretty much in like a month. It was bad, and it was just on repeat all the time. Like, there isn't anything I don't know about Friends. Did a quiz with James, like 150 questions, got like 140 plus right. It was only a few, I was like, that's a bit weird. It's a bit sad, but it's just my fave go-to. I just love it so much.
So, let's put University Challenge.
Yeah, honestly, specialist, I'll take it on.
Specialist subject.
I can so do that.
Friends, Esther. I nominate Esther.
I'll do it. So, what happens in the programme? What happens outside of it? And who created it, couldn't tell you.
Yeah.
But specific, like, quotes and lines, because like, Netflix have it, right? But I was watching it, and I was quoting the next line, as you do. And it missed out a joke, and I was like, what? I was like, I've never got that wrong. So I played my version. Because Netflix actually like cuts them shorter. Yeah, and yeah. I was like, absolutely not. So I don't want Netflix anymore for that because it ruins it.
So I'm not quite as good as that with sitcoms or things that I watch. Mm-hmm. But I know my oldest Nahum is. And we're Red Dwarfers.
Right.
And he will quote Red Dwarf to us all the time. I will quote it but get things slightly wrong. And he has to come and put me right.
I mean, I agree. Yeah.
But he gets the joke that I'm making.
Yeah, yeah.
But he knows so much word for word. So I understand that. Once you've got some of that, whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. It is.
Just nothing quite like it. Like, yeah. Nothing is funny, nothing I found. I mean, The Office is good. I do love, like, US sitcoms. But it's just nothing compared to Friends. I just can't be
it. I'm not a big fan of US sitcoms. I didn't mind Big Bang Theory to start with. But once they stopped being so geeky, I kept getting, started getting girlfriends and having what you'd call a normal life sort of thing. It takes the quirkiness away from
it.
Yeah,
why we enjoyed it in the first place.
Yeah, you know, and Friends, though I wasn't into Friends, I can see that obviously they're friends and always was friends sort of things.
Yeah, and there's such a natural progression from like their mid-20s into like their late 30s and like they have kids and then they get married and they just kind of, it was one of the only programmes I've ever watched from beginning to end that I thought has such natural progression, and also, like, being a drama freak, when you have someone that has something that has integrity, and actually, it started well, and it ends so well, and actually, it's rounded off, and you're like, it was so satisfying, it was so good, and it's, like, left there, and it's like, that's done now. Don't touch it, it's all over. I appreciated that, rather than some programmes that, like, want to just keep it going for the sake of money, but then ruin the integrity of the art, that, and obviously, Brett's Friends didn't do that.
Yeah. Brilliant.
I could talk about it for ages. We should move on.
I haven't watched a lot of Friends, to be fair. And you'll hate me for that. But
that's
there you
all right.
Go. So, the second one. So, I started typing the second one in.
Yeah.
And a couple of songs come up. I thought, Van Halen? No. No, she's not. Hang on, let me just go back to this. And I went back to my phone. I said, of course, it's not. Look.
That's not
me. No, no. But because I only started putting the name of the song in.
Yeah. I don't know what it is
now. No, because you wouldn't because I can't remember which one it is.
Oh, this is so different to Van Halen.
So this is Lovey, and obviously Cinderella come up, and Van Halen. So I clicked on Van Halen first.
Oh, this just makes me feel so
I can fly. So I'm going to assume this song, this film, was on repeat and repeat and repeat as a 4, 5, 6 year old.
I don't really remember. I mean, I grew up with Disney films, but I have two older brothers as well. So we can have, you know, like Robin Hood on and Hercules and all the other, like, you know, Toy Story, which I absolutely adore. But this kind of represents Disney. I love Disney. Disney's just, I mean, it ruined me for real life, because life isn't like Disney. I don't know why no one warned me about bills and being an adult. But especially as I got older, I had actually a few, like, key moments. I was at uni, and I was just having a bad day. I was like, you know, I'm going to put Cinderella on, forget life, I just want to sit and watch Cinderella. And I was in a bit of a mood with God, and I was like, nah, I'm done, everything just sucks, I'm just, ugh, I can't do it anymore. And then I was watching this film, and like, there's a moment when she has an awful life, right? That she loses her mum, loses her dad, then is abused for no reason, and is always smiling and still happy, still singing, still finding the joy in everything. I'm like, this girl is absolutely bonkers. And then there's a moment when she just breaks and she just gives up. She goes, I can't do it anymore. Then in comes the fairy godmother, and he's like, oh my child, but you can. And I was like, oh man. And Jesus just hit me with this whole thing of like, yeah, but that's Holy Spirit. Like, yes, I'm here. Like, that's what, like, my relationship with you is about. Like, I'm here for you in those times when you can't go on, you lean on me, you lean on Jesus, and I'll give you that strength again. I just sat there like sobbing, being like, I just had such a bad day, I really love Cinderella, and then Jesus spoke to me through Cinderella, and it just made the film just so much more beautiful to me. Because I mean, it's just how God speaks to me. And I had someone else 2 years later, I think, speak to me about Cinderella, and he was like, I don't really know you very well, but I cannot get this out of my head, so I'm going to share it anyway. And I was like, okay. You know how you are with, like, people speaking words, like, okay, we'll try. And he shared something about Cinderella and how the shoe fit her perfectly, and how I had to stop trying to fit in other people's shoes and, like, try that. It's like, you've got a shoe, you've got a life, you've got a purpose, you've got a job. Stick to that, because that's what God's made you for. And then again, I was just sobbing, being like, I can't believe this is the second time God has used Cinderella to speak to me. So it's all kind of wrapped up into that. Also, it's Disney Princess. I love being a princess. Like, I am an absolute princess. I spoiled my dad, spoiled my husband. I just love it. So that's why I loved it. And then the fact that God also used it, it just brought this whole new perspective to it. And I don't know, Disney's just, it's so easy to watch. You know what's coming. It's just colourful. It's just bright and easy. There's always a happy ending. Don't we all just love a happy ending?
To be fair, Disney and their animations doing pretty well on most of them.
Yeah. It's just, it's such a classic. And
I remember taking my lads to see Tarzan. I thought, oh, they're going to ruin Tarzan for me. Because I remember Tarzan in real films with a real chimpanzee and that. And that's how I remember it growing up.
Sure.
So I thought, let's just be prepared for it. So I'm going in expecting the worst. I've come out of Tarzan animation at Walt Disney. I thought, you know, they've done that pretty well, they have. That's pretty good. So it sort of turned me back into watching more of the Disney ones, and you start seeing how good they actually are. So I understand that. Obviously, having lads, we didn't get into too many of the princesses.
Well, sure, but it was more as I got a bit older, because I had brothers, and I have got 4 boy cousins I'm super close to. So like, I grew up around a heavily boy environment, but what I could,
I do love the story as well. You know, a rags to riches sort of thing. And
And it's just like their love is so pure.
And, the way,
and
the
that's
way
all
put,
I ever wanted.
Yeah.
And
the way you put it
into
to how Jesus spoke to you through it and how the Holy Spirit
make
like,
up, just
that,
absolutely
yeah.
broke me.
Yeah. So the next song.
Mm. I'll just take a moment. Just going to go back there. Did you know this?
No.
It's okay. We can still be friends, Dave.
But we will talk about this in a little bit.
Those genuinely makes me really emotional.
Those of you that don't know this, this is called The Shire.
Mm-hmm.
Is it from The Hobbit or The Lord of the Rings?
The Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings. Howard Shore.
Mm. Oh, man alive. I watched this, actually, on the way back from America this Christmas. It's just, I just can't explain. It's so good.
So, it doesn't surprise me that you come back to the Midlands with one of your favourite songs. Obviously, The Shire being part of The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, we know where it was written, where it was all made up.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up just down the road. I was born in 68, 1976 we moved, and where we was living in Hall Green, was right next door to Sayhole Mill. And Sayhole Mill is where Tolkien came up with his thoughts and ideas all around Lord of the Rings and that. So it makes no surprise that you come back to your Birmingham and probably your Midland roots.
Stop it. It's not wise because it's a beautiful, far-off place, all right?
And you'll be dreaming of Sir Holmer and those faggots and peas in a bit, won't you?
Oh, please. Very crazy, Dave. That's not.
For those of you that don't know, yesterday Esther and James, who is actually around somewhere, just told the rest of us that they're expecting their first child. Absolutely amazing. So Esther, James and myself are part of what's called Academy Plus 2. It's a leadership course at our church last year. And it's beautiful to watch how we've all grown. I've seen Esther, James and even myself seen us come out of ourselves so much through this leadership course. It's absolutely amazing to see. So when a member of we've already got one baby with our group,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it's our baby. I know Ash and Tanya will tell you it's theirs, but it's our baby. And this one is our second baby. Though it's Esther and James is first, it's Academy Plus 2022's second baby.
I'll tell you.
So, and it's absolutely amazing. I'm so made up for the pair of you. And I know you're going to be absolutely amazing parents, both of you are going to be amazing. Because of everything you've got around you,
mm-hmm.
you know, I know you've spoken to people, I know you've sat and chatted and spoke it through, I know you've got the support around you. And no matter what your background is and your history,
mm-hmm.
you know, I said it to James last night, and when we interviewed James at a later date, he knows how not to be a dad,
mm-hmm.
which means he knows how to be a dad. Yeah. And I said it to him last night. And that's what you do. You know how not to be. If you know how not to be, then you know how to be.
For sure.
Because you don't do the bad things. You only do the good things.
He's going to be great.
And you are. And I know you're scared and nervous. And I know my first one exactly the same. And at 3 o'clock in the morning when they're screaming and crying and you're thinking, I don't know what to do. You know.
I'll also be screaming and crying. It's going
to be fine. Yeah.
We'll just embrace the emotions together.
I didn't get quite to that crying stage, but I got to, right, let's get in the car seat, off for a drive at 3 o'clock in the morning, just to try and get back to sleep. Yeah. Yeah, there you go, James. Yeah, at least you get a drive out. so it doesn't surprise me that the show comes in and Lord of the Rings, and obviously, as we can tell, we're going down that film music sort of route as well.
Drama.
In that sense, yeah.
And it was just such a huge thing in our family. Like, I don't know where it came from, really. I just because, as I said, so I have two older brothers, and four boy cousins. We're all very close, and it's just the theme of our family. I think I don't know what it's always on. It's always something we'd go to, You never watch the... You always watch the extended edition, because otherwise, what's the point? True. And, like, my cousin, my youngest cousin, was watching them at, like, 4 years old, and, like, the orcs and the uruk-hai are awful, and they're scary. He was just sat there, like, loving life, just, like, watching, just quite happily, like, not phased. And, like, me and my friends would walk in a bit older, and they're running out screaming because it's scary. I'm like, guys, it's just orcs. Like, chill out. And I forget, like, oh, yeah, I grew up with this. It's fine. So there's a real, like, sense of comfort in the film as well. Because it reminds me of home and all that family time, and
yeah,
I just like, it's fantastical, it's mythical, it's just all made up somewhere else, and it's just, I just sometimes I'm at work and I'm like, I'm just gonna put like Lord of the Rings in my ears and pretend to be in the Shire, pretend to be somewhere else, because it's just so relaxing. I'm like, who doesn't want to live in a hobbit hole? And I would fit in one because I'm small, so it's all fine.
So I have watched them all. I have watched them all.
But have you watched the extended edition?
I must have done, because
I've watched them. Makes no sense.
I've watched them with my lads, and they're certainly now big fans. So I must have watched the extended edition. I haven't watched them 7 or 8 times though, and I wasn't a big fan of The Hobbit.
No, see, they could have done that really well if they'd done it in 2 films.
Yeah,
but they just want that, which is what bugs me about the whole like art and integrity. Like, if you're gonna make some films, if you're gonna make it from a book, like, stick to it. As verbatim as you can, make them well, make them good. Don't just make... So the third one was basically just a whole... The third book is based on 1 chapter in that book. And that really makes me mad, because I'm like, you could have done that so much better.
Yeah.
I didn't.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't... I mean, I'd watch it, because... But it's nothing like Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, not a big fan. Not a big fan of The Hobbit.
Not the films. The book is good.
Yeah. So...
For sure. For sure.
But, there we go. Let's go. Our next one.
Next.
So we will go a little bit more...
A little bit different?
A little bit Christian this time.
Ooh, just a little bit.
A little bit Christian
I was like, I don't remember putting this in my place. Oh, no, I did, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Wasn't holding you up. So there's nothing I can do to let you down. Does it take a trophy to make you proud? I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Ooh. Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. So obviously in Maverick City I've done a lot of songs. So what a genre. So this was my song for 2022. It's one of the first years I actually was like intentional. People were like, oh, do you pray about your year? Do you like get a word? And I was like, no. So that year I was like, okay, no, do you know what? I'm going to. I didn't really think anything of it, but that song kept coming up. And I was like, okay, I could see myself growing through the song. We'll pick the song. And God spoke to me about expectation, family. And that's when I really invested in like groups as well. And by the end of the year, I was like, okay, church is family, groups is family. I get that now. But it's those lyrics about, it doesn't take a trophy to make God proud, like I just have to be myself. And there's something that she sings later on, I could not tell what it is for the life of me now, because I need to remember, and it's totally escaped me. But I think it's the one, I'm sure it is, when she sings about, like, if God dresses the lilies in beauties and ashes, or how much more will he clothe you? And like, it just talks about the whole verse in Matthew about not being anxious about anything in your life. But if he's going to look after the birds and the flowers, things that are so trivial, things that come and go all the time, aren't we more precious? Like, is he not going to look after you?
Mm.
And I really held on to that. And as going in 2022, before James even signed me up to Academy Plus with him, I was like secretly like crying out for change. I was like, I'm so done with how I've been living, like stuck in anxiety, stuck just in that awful bubble. And I was like, no, I'm done. And if you can do anything, this is the year, this is the song. Like, I'll pursue it. I'm not saying it's all going to, like, come crumbling down this year, but, like, this is a point of change. And that song, like, every time I listen to it now, I'm just like, oh, when I first heard this, I was so different. And, like, I sing it now, not from, like, a place of sadness and, like, grieving for, like, crying out for God. It's just from a place of, like, joy and, like, oh, man, you healed me so much.
Yeah.
And just that place of, like, oh, I just don't need to be anything but myself. And, like, you're going to look after me because you think I'm super precious. And, like, that blows me away. Like, what the heck? So, it's a powerful song. I really enjoy it.
Even though it wasn't expecting everything to crumble down, actually everything probably did crumble down.
Oh, 100% did. Yeah, God absolutely smashed it out of the water.
Yeah.
I was not. I was like, God, we'll start the process of healing. Like, I'm so ready. Let's go. And he just went, okay. I mean, there's still recovery in that. You know, it's like 90% gone.
I totally know exactly where you're coming from.
Absolutely just blew out of the water and completely shattered every wall.
And we've shared that story with 10 other people.
Mm-hmm.
There's 3 of us here. So with 10 other people, we've shared so many of them stories.
Yeah, you guys testify.
We've watched people's lives crumble down like that. You've watched mine, I've watched yours, I've watched James.
Yeah.
You know, I know Academy Plus we've done together, but we've been to Cave, you've been to Dauntless, we've been to the Horde. You know, these were such intense weekends. When we did the Freedom Weekend, such a laugh, you know, but so intense at times.
For sure.
You know, and that is where we've seen things crumble. And seriously, think of the worst that can happen to people. And we've watched that crumble down in our lives. I've watched it in my life. Esther's watched it in hers. James has watched it in theirs. We've watched it crumble in front of us.
Yeah.
And we don't know how or even if we deserve it to some extent. We're not even sure about that. But we've made that commitment. And that because of that commitment, God is honouring us. And I love that. I love that about your story. I love that about you both. And that's why I'm so pleased about the baby on the way, because that for me is the icing on the cake sort of thing, or the cherry on the top, whichever way you want to put it. It really is.
Yeah.
So, and some of Maverick's is super.
I mean, they are just blessed of a different kind of worship. They're incredible. But yeah, that song. I mean, there's loads of. I was picking loads of their songs, like Promises as well. But no, Gyro was one. I was like, this is the song. So yeah.
So. As you know, I've got a song that I put into your playlist.
Mm-hmm.
And the one that I've put in for you, I could have put in for James. But the one that I've got for James could also be for you. But
well,
I'm not going to reveal that one.
We are one, so I'll take
it. I'm not going to reveal that one because it is a good one.
Sure.
And it was about which way I would use them. And you will get to hear the song I've got for Esther. I don't usually reveal it, but I revealed it to Esther because I don't want her to think that I'm thinking that she looked like an old thrown away doll. So I thought I'd best do that slightly different to what it is. And you'll understand what I'm talking about when we get to that song. So the next one, I think we're going back to your teenage years.
Stop, please.
I really do
think
we are.
I might cry. Because of the summer, because I'm home alone, who knows? Jim, I genuinely might cry, like the fangirl inside of me right now. Like that child, oh man. Do you not have a song that really like just makes you just want to cry? Oh, just, I can just see myself in this like child, teenager. Ah, oh, you like, oh my gosh. So good. So good. Although, yeah.
So for our older viewers, this is busted.
Oh my gosh, I just can't handle it. My heart is like, I have such a huge crush on this whole band because I mean, it's busted. Who's not gonna have a crush on Busted?
I didn't.
Okay, some people would, I guess. wish I still, different age.
We could nearly get up and dance at this, couldn't we?
I do feel like I'm going to go home and just have to play all the music now before James is going to like stop.
To be fair, obviously growing up as a parent, you will hear some of the music. It's one of the bands that I wouldn't say, why have you got that rubbish on? They're okay. It's poppy and danceable.
Although, again, one of those things I listened to when I was older and I was like, Mum, I was listening to this when I was a child. She goes, yeah, I know. I don't know how we, but you know, we did it and there we are and you're fine. And I was like, yeah, because some things, there are some notes I'm like, oh, that's a bit dodge, but not many. And I think it's just the boy band phase, right?
Yeah.
There was.
Yeah.
There was Busted and McFly and Jonas Brothers and One Direction. I kid you not, Dave. When they made Muck Busted as a thing, when I was like later on, when I was like late teens, I can't remember when they formed, maybe even recently, 20-ish, who knows. I genuinely thought I'd died and gone to heaven. Muck Busted, like McFly and Muck Busted, like Busted together. It was a dream. Absolute dream. I went to see them live. They were incredible. Oh, boy bands. It's just like that classic teenage era of like boy bands, and also Twilight was a thing then, so I had like Taylor Lautner all over my room with like Jonas Brothers and One Direction. Saw One Direction like 5 times. The first time I actually saw One Direction, I cried. Because I couldn't quite get over the fact that like famous people were in the same room as I am. I was nowhere near them because, you know, the stage was far back. But I was like, I could, in theory, I could run down, not that you can because there's security guards, I could run down the aisle, jump on stage and be face to face with them. And that just absolutely blew my mind. I just cried. Oh, this is too much. But yeah.
But you see that through history, don't you? If you go back to the Beatles, sure, you know, the pandemonium going on now where we're all screaming and fainting and things.
Honestly, look back and think, I mean, it seems a bit ridiculous. So I go to concerts now and enjoy them, but you're like, but they're just people. And like, I have a good life, I enjoy my life. But honestly, that, like, when you're young, it's just, and I was definitely in love with all these boys. I don't know what happened, but you know, Jonas Brothers, love them. One Direction, loved all of them, and Busted. I actually cried myself to sleep when it came on the news that Busted broke up. I genuinely cried myself to sleep. It was the saddest. I think I, like, there's a film, Teenage Confessions of a Teenage Drama Queen, right, with Lindsay Lohan in. When that band breaks up, she basically goes into full mourning. I was in the same. I was like, I was full mourning because Busted had broken up. I was like, I don't think I can live. Like, Busted aren't a band anymore. Anyway, I recovered, and I'm okay.
And you've been to see him live?
Yeah, I've seen Busted, I've seen McFly, I've seen Jonas Brothers, seen One Direction 5 times. Wow. Yeah, so I've seen them a lot, yeah. And just, I don't know, it's just that age. You just love, and I just go back and I just think, I could be a teenager. And like, you just imagine them all singing to you because they know who you are.
Yeah.
Of course they do. Oh, it's just something about it that just, I don't know. You look back and you think, you were a crazy little child. But
we all have our phases, and we all have music that we loved growing up. Doesn't matter whether it, in your case, it's a boy band. You know, I was into rock.
Sure.
You know, I loved a bit of AC/DC, Judas Priest. You know, Status Quo, Slade.
See, say
Rainbow.
Status Quo, my head goes High School Musical. So, but.
And
such nostalgia comes with those things.
Yeah.
Like, I just remember, like, playing those. And you get them on CDs. Like, no one has CDs anymore. Except I still do, for I can't. And I have Busted all on CDs. I have all Busted. All of McFly. All of One Direction. And you just put this, although not their latest stuff, you put the CD on and you just have to play the whole CD. If you had a fancy CD player, you could shuffle it, but it's very fancy. So or normally you just, like, repeat the same song.
Is there a band, group, or person that you wish you'd seen that you hadn't seen?
Ooh. Well, it's quite a bittersweet moment, right? Okay, I'll talk about it because I'm comfortable today with your share. So I quite like Muse growing up. My oldest brother does as well. My mum is into it. So we like the music as a family, really. And one day, couldn't tell you why, mum was convinced, she'd asked me if I'd like to go to a concert. And apparently I said no. Now, I can't remember this unless she asked when I was like half comatose from being asleep. But then my whole family went to see Muse without me. And I didn't go. That's quite sad. I'm not bitter or anything. I'm not bitter. But I do remember that moment being like, she's like, mum's like, but I'm just, and bless her, my mum felt so bad. I was like, mum, why would I ever say no to that? Like, if I'd said no, you should have questioned me. Like, why would I not have wanted to do that?
Yeah. Hand on your head. Right. Are you all right?
But I think they were all Coldplay. Coldplay would have been insane. It's like, but
have you not been to see Coldplay?
No. But like, especially when they were like starting out, they're ridiculously expensive to see now because they're so huge. I think I'd have liked to see them when they were earlier on, but yeah, I'm just like, I'll see them if I want to, but also I'm content with life. Whereas when I was a lot younger, music was so intense. I was like, I have to see everybody on stage all the time because it was such a big thing. Whereas now I'm like, I've seen them fine, if not.
Is there anybody you've seen that you think, wish I hadn't seen them?
There was. Who did I go and see that I was like, could live with that? The Script. They were alright, but I think it was just because a friend was going, and again, I was at the age of like, we all just do concerts because we're. It's like you're supposed to be old enough to go anywhere by yourself. We went to Birmingham, went to that the arena, and then, yeah, but I'm like, oh, I could forget that.
So, I didn't go and see Tom Robinson when I was younger. People don't know Tom Robinson. Even people my age, yeah. Most of them will not know who Tom Robinson is. And I didn't get to see him when I was younger.
Sure.
And just before COVID hit,
mm.
I'd seen that he was doing a tour. I thought, and because he's not so famous, yeah. he was only in small places. So he was in I think the King's Arms or something like that in King's Heath, which is obviously a suburb of Birmingham. I thought, oh, good, we'll get tickets for that. COVID hit, gets cancelled. So I still didn't get to see him. So I haven't been to see him yeah. in live. I do keep my eyes out in case.
Yeah.
But my confession of who I have seen live, though I didn't pay for it, and I did go with my family and my parents.
Yeah.
But I saw the Brotherhood of Man. And if not you go thing. Back to Brotherhood of Man, oh my word. I'm not scarred.
Yeah. sure, sure. I believe you.
So, and I still sing Save All Your Kisses for me. with my big flares. Oh,
hey, I'm all for flares.
Yeah, but purple ones. You might get away
Please.
With purple ones, but
purple
I might not.
Flares.
I might not. Well, I might because of my colours, but most people, most people wouldn't get away with purple flares. I might just be able to pull it off.
Oh yeah, I mean that's just like a dream.
I am quite calm at the moment. I like to play. I also got to see Bugsby, but Bugsby's were quite good live, to be fair.
Imagine.
But I've seen a lot of rock bands, and obviously I do a big church day out now, so I've seen loads of Christian bands all the time. I think if I was talking about the best Christian band I've seen live that do proper good live worship is Ren Collective.
Yes.
Their album music is not as good.
No, it's more studio produced.
When they're live, they are absolutely.
So yeah.
They are so bouncy. They are, and you get that when they're live. You get how spirit filled
they are. And they're not about performance. They're all about worship with you, and that's why I love
it. And it's about us. Yeah. It's not about us. We're just leading you. Come and join the journey with us. And Red Collective are absolutely brilliant at doing that. Absolutely brilliant.
I totally agree.
So what's
I mean, I picked them on. I still feel a bit of like anticipation.
Ah, oh, there we are. Definitely you.
Okay.
We're coming to. Yeah, we are coming to where we are. What's this one called? Some dancing something, isn't it?
Generation.
No, that's further down.
Dancing
the line.
Through life.
That's the one. Yeah.
From Wicked.
That's the one. Believe
me, I've been kicked out of enough of that. Now I'm very tempted to go for an active dance, but I won't. I must hold that back.
You must.
I must.
We can push the chairs back.
No. It's not the Esther show.
We can get to the kitchen. There's a lot of space in the kitchen.
It's a 7-minute long song. You won't get me to stop.
So how many times have you seen Wicked?
Only twice. Which is really sad. But actually they're both in London. The first time I saw it was with my parents. For my 19th birthday, they took me to London. And I'd listened to the music, so I knew the whole story before. Yeah. And they took me, and the music started, and I instantly cried. I'm a very emotional person. I feel like crying is a normal reaction for me. I cry everything. If I'm angry, sad, happy, just cry everything. But I'd been listening, and I just started college. I just finished college. I met other performing artists who love musicals, because that was like what we went to drama. I went to college and did a drama course. And my friends they lived with, they never heard of it before then. I was like, oh, okay. I'd heard of Popular, because that's super popular. And then I started listening to the whole thing, and I knew the whole story then because of the music, and basically tells the story. I was like, I've just got to see this musical. Like, I might die if I don't see this musical. So my parents took me to see it. I just fell in love with it. It's such a classic musical. Like, it just tells the whole story. It's very dramatic, very musical theatre. The songs are super classic. Like, it just makes sense that everyone's breaking out in song to tell their stories and have an emotion. And I relate so much to that, because every time I have an emotion, I want to sing about it. Mm-hmm. And I want to get it out, and I want to be emotional. I'm very dramatic as a person. And yeah, this was the first time I think I learned with some friends at college, and I think that's why it's also so special, because there's so many good Wicked songs. But, you know, like Defying Gravity, everyone knows that. Popular, everyone knows that. But Dancing Through Life just goes on this whole journey, and it's just real the beginning of you start to see the characters. I love it so much. Just, oh, I just can't explain how I love it so much. Like, because I love lots of musicals, but like, this is a classic. And it's just my fave of all time.
So one of the reasons why I wanted to do the podcast, because music, I'm not a singer,
sure.
not musically in the slightest, but music means so much in our lives.
Oh, for sure.
Songs mean so much to us at any time.
Yeah.
And we can all tell a story around songs.
Mm-hmm.
We can all tell a testimony, we can tell a story, we can, well, it reminds me of this, oh, this was a sad moment, this was so exciting, this was brilliant, this was that, oh, this is where I know God spoke to me, or this is where, you know, we've got... So when we had our dog put down, so we had a song. I trod on the dog's tail once, and we started singing Winter's Tale to him. And instead of singing Winter's Tale, we started singing Dodgy's Tail.
Sure.
I've accidentally trod on Dodgy's tail and turned it into a song.
Sure.
Changed the words for it. But obviously, when he passed away, that song suddenly becomes a little bit more emotional because he's now no longer here.
Sure.
So that song becomes even more special in our lives.
Yeah, exactly.
That at Christmas, when we hear it, it brings tears to our eyes because our dog, and the dog, you know, it's not as if he only lasted 5 or 6 years. He lived with us for 13 years. I also didn't remember life without him, you know, until he passed away. He didn't remember life without the dog.
That's
crazy. So we had a little funeral for him. We played the song at the funeral, and all of us absolutely in tears. But that's why I love music so much, because it gives us those special moments. And that song, Winter's Tale. So when we do a Christmas special, it's definitely going on the playlist.
Sure.
Absolutely going on the playlist. And if it doesn't, it'll go on a playlist somewhere else, because I'll give it to someone else.
Sure.
Oh, it's going on your playlist. Why? Because I've decided. And there will be a theme. There are groups and songs that will make it. So, Red Collective will make it. Skillet's going to make it a lot. Skillet will make it a lot. I love Skillet. We'll even try and stick. And Jesus Freak will make it in anybody's. If you give me a chance to put Jesus Freak in, I would have put Jesus Freak in.
All right, I'll take it any day. My musicals, acting, being dramatic.
Yeah.
I'll know more about it.
So, isn't it the best art form to go and watch theatre?
Yes.
It is.
Good theatre.
It is.
I have sat through some plays and I'm like, okay. Well, we're here now. You're doing a good job.
Yeah.
But yeah, if you can watch a good one, if they can just pull it together.
Yeah, so I'm assuming then I haven't seen a bad one. So if I...
Maybe I'm just too critical. That could be a thing. Because you see, I've seen things like Star Wars, the one of the new ones. And I love Star Wars. Didn't like the new ones very much. But that's because I didn't like the actor in it, who plays Rey. And that could be an unpopular opinion. No, I don't mind. But when I was watching, I was like, just move your face, like, acting. Can you just do something? But then, because I was so focused on her acting, I don't remember the story, because I just sat in the cinema with my family being like, no, she just did that better. Like, can you move your face? Okay, cool, good. Maybe I'm just too critical, I don't know.
I also like a lot of amateur dramatics. So, Crescent Theatre in Birmingham. They're all amateurs, and they are classy.
Yeah, but so much is very good.
I've seen some of the stuff there, and obviously it's a lot cheaper and things to go and watch. So you go and see some stuff, and it is absolutely brilliant.
That's also where you get the best acting, though, because they actually have a passion for it, because
they've
not got no fallback. Like, whereas if you're paid to do it all the time, I know you're not paid all the time, but paid for a show, I don't always think, like, you know, West End, because we're in the UK.
Yeah.
West End isn't always the best, and there are some but you know, amateurs are good.
Yeah.
Because they've got that passion to do it as well.
I think watching The Sound of Music at the theatre is probably
that
my favourite.
Beautiful.
It's probably my favourite. The way they did it there, the way they had the thunder and rain and things like that. How they got
that's
that.
It's clever, right?
It is, I think that's probably my favourite Sound
Adds
of Music.
To the magic of it. Oh, Sound of Music is beautiful.
But I'm a live event sort of person as well.
Yeah.
I love live events.
For sure. Yeah.
And you can't beat it. You know, I'll sometimes be walking through a park and there's a cricket match going on. I'll stop and watch it. Mm. Don't know who's playing.
Couldn't care less. No, I love the live
event. Because it's a live event and it's there. You know, I'll walk through the park and there's a band on the bandstand and you know, you go, well, have a little listen to these. Because I just love live. Yeah. So, yeah, so I haven't seen Wicked. I haven't seen Wicked. So I do apologise again.
That's okay.
So,
I'll forgive you.
That was that one. So we're going to stay on the theme because this one, this one, that's a bit, I've looked into this one a little bit. I've done a little bit of research on the writers of this.
Interesting one.
An interesting one.
Before I even turn the key, before I make the mistake, before I leave with the worst of me, give them no reason to stare.
I got a feeling not many people will know this one.
Maybe not this one.
Nothing to share. No, I got nothing to say. Step out, step out of the sun if you keep getting burned. Step out, step out of the sun because you've learned, because you've learned.
But if you want someone to listen to, listen to Ben Black. It's his voice. It's ridiculous.
So I've never heard of the musical Dear Evan Hansen. Never heard of the music on, so...
Relatively new. I can't remember when it came out, but...
So, I thought I'd do a bit of research on what I can. Firstly, I found out Owl City did the song. You know Owl City?
Yeah.
Know much about Owl City?
No, but I remember a song they used to do all the time, but again, it's Fireflies, that song, isn't it? I don't know where I remember that song, but that's where I remember Owl City.
So we have an Owl City fan as the producer here.
Nice.
So he likes Owl City, and we have discovered that the lead singer, at least, he's a born-again Christian as well. So
nice.
I don't know about the rest of the band, so I didn't do that much. But actually, I decided to look at who wrote this song, Waving Through a Window. Sounds like a strange name for a song. And I can imagine just the play, and I can imagine the theatre, and I can imagine somebody just standing in a window waving, tapping on the door, waving. Because that's what it sounds like to me.
It does, yeah.
And that's what they're singing about. And to some extent, does that not sound like our lives? When we're walking around, we'll just find something to sing about. You know, we will
find something to sing about.
We'll always find something. And you know, we'll even change lyrics so that it fits to a song that we know.
Yeah.
And we'll sing about it, you know, like treading on your dog's tail.
Yeah.
So I've had to put on my family chat because when we were young, we used to sing a song called Penny's Hat. We had a dog called Penny.
Yeah.
And we had a dog called Penny, and we used to sing a song to a song called Penny's Hat. We used to go, Penny's Hat, Penny's Hat. And the other day, it come to me, I put on, what was that song? And not, well, they've all started to. And anyway, I found Google something. I started singing into Google thing. It come back to me, a song called Forever Now. So I played Forever Now, and it is that. It, Forever Now, Forever Now.
But you changed it.
And I would change it to Penny's Hat. All these years on, I always thought it was cool.
What, you know when you sing, I was like, do you remember this song? And people were like, no, that's definitely a thing.
Yeah.
Maybe it never is a thing.
I always called it Penny's Hat. I always thought it was called Penny's Hat. I always thought it was Penny's Hat by Darts, a group called Darts. Not at all.
Not
at all. No. Darts were a band.
Okay.
Penny's Hat's not a song at all. And Forever Now isn't sang by Darts. So I looked into this, and the writers of that song, Waving Through the Window, are Benj Pazek and Justin Paul.
Okay.
Obviously, he had a little look at them, went to university together, started writing tunes at university and did things at university. But would you believe that they have been part of the Disney universe?
I've maybe just sensed it.
Okay.
I just sensed it.
So... They have written and performed for James and the Giant Peach.
Mm-hmm.
They've done music for La La Land. And they have done music for Live Aladdin.
I didn't know all that, actually.
Yeah?
No way. I just said, I'm a senses thing.
Yeah, I'm a senses thing.
Because he just finds me.
Yeah, yeah. So, and I, obviously, when I put Ben Platt in, he come up actor, and I'm thinking, oh, have I got the wrong one? Have I got the wrong Ben Platt? And obviously, I'm doing your research, you're finding them sort of things out.
Yeah.
So, I don't know much about Ben Platt. I didn't look into Ben Platt. But,
just an incredible
that, it is quite a good song, to be fair. I do quite like that Waiting for a Window. And I might do a bit more into that.
Musical level. Yeah, the musical is incredible. And that's why I chose it, because it came at a real... I'd heard it in uni before. So when I went to uni 2017 to 2020, I heard it in about 2020. And I was like, oh man, that just sounds really weird. This guy like breaks his arm and then like pretends what? Okay, I don't really understand. And then when the film musical came out, and I was like, oh well, this means I can watch it. And then if I like it, I'll see it in theatre, because it's a lot cheaper to watch a movie than go to the theatre. And I remember watching it, and I actually watched it too much. And like, so it's about like a guy with mental health and anxiety, social anxiety, and there's lots of different ties, and then it's a beautiful, like, it's incredible, but it's super heavy as a watch. And actually, James had to put a ban on me watching it, because it would just make me cry and cry and cry. Because it's just so, like, you listen to those lyrics, and it was so cathartic to have someone else explain how I felt. And so you listen back to those lyrics, and he's talking about, like you're stuck behind this thing you can't get through. You're always trying to get involved with people, but you can't physically get there. And then he's like, well, just step out of the sun if you keep getting burnt. Like, don't keep trying if you're just going to keep getting burnt. Like, don't keep trying to talk to people if it's going to fail, it's going to backfire. If you can't quite get out of that zone, just give in, just stop. And he's like, we all want to shine. We all want to be a better person. We want to be out, but we can't. And it was just so, I listened to it and just was like, I can't believe someone is explaining how I feel to an absolute T. And so James was like, got to put, like, he had to ban me from watching it, because it was too triggering for my anxiety at that time. And I think that's when my anxiety peaked and I realised I need to stop living like this. And there's a really tough relationship in the film between a sister and her brother. So her brother killed herself and she's struggling to deal with that. And I've not experienced that, but I have a difficult relationship with my brother recently. Just things have all happened. And I was watching their relationship and I was like, it's just like copying my life. And I just couldn't quite... It has been so hard to process it all. So when you're seeing it and people are like almost explaining it out of you, it was so cathartic and so painful, but also so good, because it was so freeing and releasing. I was like, ah, that's what I feel. That's why I'm struggling. Or like, the heck, other people feel this way. And then you start talking about mental health and start talking about anxiety, and you realise so many people feel the way this Evan character does. And like, I watched it with James. He didn't quite understand this at the end. Like, he just starts lying and lying and lying for a good cause, and because he just can't not. And like, James is like, but he should have just told the truth in the beginning. I'm like, but that's not how his brain works. And like, I got it. Like, I completely understand. I never had to express that before. And I was like, I totally understand why he said that one white lie, which led to another, which led to, because it just spirals and you just can't. And he gets to the end point and he's just absolutely broken and trying to like cry it out and like be sorry. And I was like, oh crud, this is too much. I would so recommend it. But like, it is super triggering. So watch with caution if you struggle with those kind of things. But that's why it was written, I think, to make the point of reach out, you're not alone. And like, there's another song, it's called You Will Be Found, that's a lot more famous, that talks exactly about that. And it's just saying, like, if you're struggling with anxiety, depression, any form of mental health, reach out to people, because you're not alone. Like, so many people struggle with it, so many people experience it, especially in today's society, especially since after COVID, it's just peaked ridiculously. And I think that's why I connected with it so much, because again, it was about singing about your emotion, which I'm all about. And it was singing and unearthing this thing I'd had for 10 years I could never fully express, until this song, Waving Through a Window, these writers wrote about it. And I was just like, oh my goodness, that's exactly how I feel. Like, if you want to know what I'm feeling, if you want to know what I'm struggling with, listen to the words of these songs, because I can't express it any better than this. Like, music is powerful. Music is just incredible, and how it can, you know, relate to so many memories and precious moments, but also how it can be so cathartic in like healing people. And just, I just really understood then at that moment like where my anxiety came from, what it really was about, because someone else put it into words. Yeah. Where I was just like, oh, flip. And that kind of triggered everything else in the start of the whole journey of like a cat being like, okay, it's time to change now. It's time to move on from this, God, like get released from this, or like learn how to live with it in a healthy way. So yeah, it's an incredible musical, but can be very triggering, so be careful. But yeah.
So with mental health, because obviously you say that you've suffered with anxiety and then sort of things with your mental health.
Mm.
So how many people do you think sort of out there would have, because obviously there'll be people watching this will have mental health issues.
Mm.
How popular, I'm not sure the quite word.
Yeah, you
know,
I get what
you
mean, yeah.
But how many people out there do you think suffers with it? Do you think most people do? 90%?
Probably, yeah. You could look left or right and find someone. Like, and that's the thing, is everyone has mental health that needs looking after, and everyone can have dips in it. It's the mental health struggles and the battles that come that then it becomes an issue and a thing that needs, you know, maybe counselling or like medication or like focus on dealing with and being aware of. But it's sadly so common. It's sad in the sense of that it captures and restricts so many people, but there's a, such a huge community of people that you can rely on and actually talk to and realise, oh yeah, like I'm not alone, like it's not, I'm not weird, it's just, that's how my brain works. Like some people, like, they have chemical imbalance which causes mental health, and so they need medication to balance out to kind of function, whereas some people it's brought on by trauma, or some people it's brought on just by like a stressful situation, a stressful season. And it can just manifest in so many different ways and through so many different, it changes, it comes out in people differently, but you kind of can't relate directly, but you know that, oh, I'm not weird. It is manageable, it is livable, like it's not the be all and end all of me, it's not who I am. It might be a part of who I am forever or for a time, but like ultimately, that's not how I was designed to be. And I can get through that, I can live that, I can bear that cross if that's what I'm supposed to. God can heal me from that, or there's just people around that get it. And I think, sadly, yeah, you could look left or right and find people that struggle with it.
Which is weird, really, because you think that if we said 90% of people have had problems with mental health at some point in their life,
yeah,
why do we find it so hard to talk about it?
Yeah, it's weird.
If it's normal for us to have mental health issues,
yeah,
why do we find it hard to talk about it?
Yeah, I don't know. I think we did this at work a few weeks ago, mental health awareness, first aid training, actually. First aid mental health trainer, don't know what it means, but I got it.
I've also done that as well.
But it was great. But it was, we did this exercise, and it was like, if you were at a wedding, would you share, you know, you've been through this, they kind of gave you signs, would you share with the person next to you? And I was like, for all of the answers, it was like, would you share with, like, if you're going for a job, or if you're going for this? And in all of them, I was like, heck yeah, like, I'm not ashamed. Why would I be? And it was more to the fact of, I wouldn't necessarily share, you know, the nitty gritty of like panic attacks and like anxiety attacks and how horrific they can be. But it's like, if I'm going for a job, like when I went for my job, I was like, no, I'm generally okay. Like I do struggle with anxiety and like I can get very overwhelmed really easily, but I know what my triggers are. I'm like, I'll just take myself away, maybe give me like half an hour, and like, I'll be honest with you if I'm having an anxiety attack, but I'll come back, that I can come back. Like, I was super honest because people need to know, because they need to be aware, you need to be sensitive to that. And I was like, I was at a wedding and someone else was struggling with it. Why would you not share your experience to make them feel less uncomfortable? And I don't know, maybe it's just, I don't know, a generational thing, or because I was just, at that point we did the mental health training, Jesus had completely just freed me from it, miraculously, like, just took it all away. Absolutely bonkers. Most incredible miracle I've ever experienced in my life. That I was just at that moment like, why would I not share that with people? Why would I not want people to know that, like, yes, you can live with it, yes, it is okay, but you don't have to, and also there's a way through. And I was just like, it didn't make sense. Whereas some people a bit older than me were like, oh, I wouldn't, or like, no, because you might not get the job. And I'm like, I'm not going to get the job. I'm not going to get it because of anxiety. I'm not going to get it because God doesn't want me to. I don't know, maybe it's just being the position of a Christian, like, God, everything is in God's hands, that I'm like, nothing I can say is going to stop that. If God wants me there, I'll be there. I'm not going to not be honest. So, yeah. But it is tough to talk about. And I think it's easy now I'm out of it.
Yeah.
In those moments, especially when you don't understand it yourself. Like, Paul James, when we got together, he had some crazy times when I just burst into his uni room and, like, been absolute, like, heaving, sobbing mess. And he'd be like, it's okay. you're okay, breathe. Because he had no idea, but I had no idea, and it's actually just, I just need to be somewhere safe where I can get the emotion out.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we can talk about it, or since I couldn't talk, because you don't know, and it's so scary to be out of control of your own body. But I think now on the other side of it, it's easy to talk about and comfort people and explain. Actually, yeah, like, it's tough to watch, and I explain to James all the time, like, I know it's hard for you to watch, but, like, it's hard to go through as well, and I get that balance as well, and see my parents deal with me as well. It's not pleasant to see someone go, and you cannot do anything, like, you can't be there for that, you can't take that away from them, you can't deal with them for that, but I'm like, but what you can do, knowing that I'm out of it now, what I really appreciated was just someone being there, no matter what, to talk or not to talk, but just someone who was consistent, just someone who was there, just someone who, no matter how crazy I acted, would come back and be like, but I still love you, and it's okay, and like, it was just a moment, it was just a time, it was just an anxiety attack, because they can be pretty horrific. So yeah, it's easy, I think, once you come out of it.
So if we tried to relate that into something that we could physically see, so let's say we've absolutely smashed our leg and it's broken in 8 places and we're having to stay in hospital for 3 months. So that's it. So we can see the injury, we can see the problem.
Yeah.
Everything that you've just said, we still need.
Yeah.
So when I'm laying in bed in a hospital with a broken leg in 8 places, I actually still need somebody to talk to.
Yeah.
I still need somebody to come along and make it. I'm still going to crack up.
Yeah.
So why do we are we able to talk about our broken leg in 8 places, but we're not able to talk about our broken brain?
It's because it's just physical. I don't know. There's something obviously there's something about the brain that would just seem like
we feel
it's just I'm just too weak, or like I'm just not strong enough. And it's like, actually, no, you're plenty strong.
Yeah.
Like you just you got a flip and not going on, and it's because we're so it's so easy to compare. Like you can break everyone can break a leg.
Yeah.
And like if you like if I don't know. Someone whacked my shin, your shin, probably going to break our shins. Whereas, like, the same thing that might mentally, like, break me, if you want to use the right, that's not the right phrase, but if something was going to, if I went through an experience, you went through experience, it would affect me way different than you.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, I think, a thing, is that, okay, so, I, like, childhood experiences and adverse childhood effects, something that one goes through could affect someone very differently. Whereas, like, if I've been through a traumatic experience, you've been through the same traumatic experience, it will depend on just how it was done to you or at what age. And it's just, you just can't compare it. So I think when someone says, like, I've got anxiety, I'm like, no, but I've got anxiety. Actually, it's not comparable. It's like, oh, so I get you feel isolated. I get that you struggle to do anything some days because I get super overwhelmed and you're like, well, me too. And that's great. But figuring out the roots and the triggers are so different. And yeah, we all have different mental capacity.
Yeah.
Like our bodies, our physical bodies all break roughly the same. So you bend your elbow back the wrong way, it's probably going to break.
Yeah.
Whereas like I can endure like 12 hours of my darling husband talking about carpentry. Other people might not be able to. Yeah, it's just one of those things. We all have different brains. We're all wired differently. And it's just a harder one to measure. And it's just all about, you have to be really confident, which I think is sad and stay psyched. We're not so confident in knowing ourselves.
Yeah.
And actually saying like, actually, I know my limits. I know my capacity. I don't really enjoy being around people because it super drains me, but that doesn't mean I don't enjoy spending time with people. It's just after or before, I'm like, I need to spend time on my own to get energy so that I can go and be with people and enjoy that. Otherwise, I'm a bit grumpy. And that's just because I know myself. I'm not unpleasant. I don't not like being with people. I just know myself to know that they drain me because my anxiety was social anxiety. Like, there are still triggers or there are still learnt behaviours that I'm trying to get out of now that have been drilled into me for 10 years because of that. It's just different capacity. Everyone's built differently, everyone's wired differently, everyone's had different experiences. You're not soft, you're not weak, you're not incapable, just different. I think that's the hardest thing to remember. Yeah.
And when I, so in my job I have to interview people sometimes for jobs, and because of the way corporate interviews go now, we have a list and that. But when I used to interview people, one of the questions I'd always ask is, how do you either deal with your own mental health or how do you de-stress?
Yeah.
There were questions that I would ask something similar to that, because I want to know that they've got the ability to de-stress.
To recognise when they're at a tough point. And yeah, for sure.
So if somebody's asked me that question, I know that, that either playing football or playing squash or just doing something physical actually helps with my mental health. So because I'm aware of that, I know that I don't really suffer with problems with mental health,
mm-hmm.
but is that because I'm aware that if I don't look after it,
yeah.
it could get worse?
100%.
And that's, and when we talk of 90%, would I be in that 90% of people that have it, mm-hmm. or am I in the 10% that don't?
Yeah.
And I would say that actually I could have mental health problems, but mm-hmm. I'm in a place where I look after it.
Yeah.
So that I'm hoping that it doesn't.
It's like anything develop. Else. It's like your emotional health, your physical health,
yeah.
your spiritual health. Any that's the thing as well, is anyone could get it, and you like you said, you have to look after it. You have
yeah.
to be aware, and I think that's something maybe people aren't aware of how to look after themselves and how to. You talk about self care, but actually like. A lot of self-care is like, take a bubble bath, like, read a book.
Yeah.
Actually, it's like, I mean, I love a bubble bath, and no, I'm going to turn that down. But, like, so for me, it would be, like, playing on my Switch, or, like, spending time with James.
That's it.
I mean, I do enjoy the outdoors as well. Actually, at times, it will change. Some days, I'm like, no, today I need a walk. And it's just about knowing what you need when you need it, whereas some days I come home from work, I'm like, I don't want to be around people. I want to go to my bed, and I want to play my Switch, and I want to fall asleep. Because at that moment, to, like, feel whole again, to kind of reset and to like make sure that my brain feels better, that's what I need to do, you know. So it's hard because there's no set formula. You just have to real know yourself and trust
yeah.
what you're saying is right, and not push yourself. So I still go out and do social things, I still talk to people, because that's good for me as a person, you know. Otherwise I would hermit and I would see no one.
Yeah.
And that's not healthy.
So we've just come out of the not just, but the last series before the one we've just finished, we've come out of Up the Mountain.
Yeah.
And for me, I experienced two really different going up the mountains in that.
Mm.
And the one, I went up the mountain on my own.
Yeah.
I went out and climbed Hay Bluff on my own, just me.
Mm-hmm.
Something that I've never really thought of doing before and felt God challenging me. So I actually went and climbed a mountain on my own. And it's so amazing. I'm not used to being on my own. I am very much somebody who likes to be socialising, fellowshipping with people
yeah.
around me. I'm not, you know, when you come from a big family, you're used to so many people around you that you feel lost when you're on your own.
Yeah.
So to be able to actually climb a mountain, be on my own, and when I got to the top, I just thought I'd get up to the top, walk back down, go home. Got to the top, I thought, actually carry on. And carried on
yeah.
walking some more along the
flat, yeah.
along the flat, and carried on walking and walking.
Mm.
And it was so amazing to just spend that time on my own, going through my thoughts, going through my prayers, talking to God, trying to get some sort of vision for where God's leading me. And it was such an amazing experience. But then we went up with the barbarians, up to the ski ridge, where there's 14, 15, 20 of us, can't remember how many. At the top, sharing at the top. And it was the same kind of experience. Whoa, it's amazing. It's
yeah.
brilliant up here. And I'm doing exactly the same, but with more people.
Mm-hmm.
And it is quite weird that, but you get to there and you do feel that release. You feel that that's part of getting your mentality into a place that you can deal with.
Yeah, sure.
And I just think, and then we use that as a metaphor. Is that the
metaphor.
Word? Metaphor. To I'm a bit dyslexic, so I'll see the word.
That's all right. I got you.
So I'll see that.
Yeah.
So I'll see that, and then you can start putting that into your life.
Mm.
You know, I'll actually have to be up a mountain. I can just be up in my bedroom.
Yeah.
And have the same experience.
Sure.
But it's then starting to relate those.
Yeah.
So those of you that obviously suffer with mental health, if you are going to go and watch Dear Evan Hansen,
yes.
just be aware that it may trigger some mental health problems. It may help you to have a look and understand how you might be able to recover or help. If you have got mental health problems, just get in touch with somebody. If you want to get in touch with us through the podcast, yeah, be more than welcome. If you want to speak to any of us, I'm sure Esther could make herself available. I'd definitely make myself available. Mental health is a real thing. It really is. I work with rough sleepers. I see mental health all the time, and it's heart-wrenching sometimes. So don't be afraid of mental health. I think I agree that 90% of people have some form of mental health issue. So don't think you're weird. Don't think you're abnormal. It's actually the norm. It's to have some sort of issues. It's how we deal with it after that. it's being strong enough and brave enough to actually address that. You know, the amount of times that we also talk about, oh, I've broke this. Well, I've broke 9 bones. Well, I've done my foot 7 times. We brag about how many breakages we have. So why are we not bragging about having mental health issues? Because in reality, it's just another part of our body broke down. Mm. And we just have to realise that our body is a human body and it breaks down. So don't be scared of it. Address it.
Yeah.
Get help. If you want support anywhere here, you want prayer, you just put a message on the app or however it works, and we will respond. We will pray for you. So we also have an email address that through this podcast we've decided to go with, and the email address is Godstory, GODSTORY, Godstory. If it does make any difference, it's all in capitals, but I'm not sure it does, at proton.me. So that's Godstory at proton, proton.me. So Godstory at proton.me. And yeah, if you email us, we will hopefully respond within 24 hours. I'm not going to guarantee that, because if I get 270 emails, I'm going to be struggling. But yeah, if you want to respond, ask questions, if you want any support, any prayer, any advice, any help, anywhere you want to be directed to, yep, then you just email and it will get a response from us. ASAP it will be. So we've cut this into the podcast is for that reason, is that we want to be able to reach out as well. And it give you somewhere to reach out to. So if you want to reach out to Godstory, then you do so. It's Godstory at proton.me. More than welcome. Any questions? If you enjoyed it, you can email me as well. There will be comments at the bottom that you can put in, and you can put comments in at the bottom as well, but in whichever way you want to. I'll go back to my original stance. So just thank you for that, and thank you for touching on the mental health, because it can sometimes be really difficult for people to talk about, and that's how far you've come, you know, that's how far you've come through the things you've done, and the things that, in Academy Plus this time last year, you would have struggled to talk about that.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have been here, Dave.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm like, oh, it's nice, you crack on. That's, you know, if I would have spoken to you, who knows?
Yeah, that's
very
true.
Very different.
So what we just doing? We've done that one, so we'll go.
Hmm.
We'll go. Power of a dancing.
There's just some like, I just wonder what's coming.
The other dancing one.
I do. Oh yeah, the other dancing one. I'm with it.
The other dancing one.
The other dancing.
This is the live version. I think.
This is the non
live. I think the Baptist Church might even know Matt Ragnall.
Who doesn't know Matt Ragnall? Oh, what a guy.
You get a big church out there. I've seen quite a few times. It's true.
Mm.
Who doesn't love that, Matt Redman?
Right.
He's got so much praise and worship music out there that you can just bop along to. He is. And to be fair, it's one of his songs that put me onto listening to Governor B. Because he does Let My People Go.
Yeah.
Governor B did a version with him. And when not Governor B did that, I thought, I have to listen to Governor B, aren't I? So I went.
I don't.
It's not my cup of tea.
Yeah.
And I went a bit just out. I thought, well, I'm going to give you a chance now.
Mm.
I went and listened to it. And I tried to block out that it's rap and that sort of stuff because it isn't my cup of tea.
Mm.
But I then started listening to his words in his rapping. Yeah.
Sure.
And they were so amazing words that after the event, I went to try and see him.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he does the signings and that I didn't get a chance to.
Yeah.
So when I come home from there, from Big Church Now, I got onto the laptop, found him on Facebook or one of them,
sure.
And actually messaged him.
Yeah.
I just told him that this is a situation. I actually bought his CD and give it to someone.
Nice.
Because I wanted to support him,
yeah.
But I didn't know how to really, because he really. So that's what I bought his CD and I gave it to him. I just went round and said, yeah, can I have that?
Nice.
Because I knew, and I just reached out to him and said, look, I said, it's not my cup of tea, but I have to say, your words are absolutely amazing and keep that work going, keep it up. And he messaged me back, he said, oh, thank you, that's really, really, he said, I know my music's not for everyone, he said, but it's about reaching those that I can reach.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's what I love.
And he does.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, and somebody says to me once, well, isn't all Christian music the same? And I said, okay.
No,
I said, okay. I said, you put me, okay.
So you made the same chord.
I says, let's go. Okay, Matt Redman, Red Collective. Okay, so I started naming a few. I said, yeah, I can sort of see it, says, but can't we do that with normal
pop
groups
songs
as well? You know, so how is Katy Perry different to Little Mix? So how are they different to some of the Kylie Minogue stuff? How are they different?
Sure.
And they start stumbling. I says,
yeah.
Exactly. I says, but let's have another listen. Let's have a look at Metallica. So well, Metallica and Katy Perry. Oh yeah. I says, so there's a difference.
Mm.
I says, so let's have a look at Skillet and Matt Redman. Let's have a look at Matt Redman and Governor B.
Yeah.
Let's have a look at Skillet and Governor B. Same music. Not at all.
Mm.
I says, I can lump people together.
Yeah.
But I can tell you the ones that are not.
For sure. Yeah.
And that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
So, you know, Blessed Be the Lord by Matt Redman. Do you know the story behind that?
No.
Okay, so Matt and Beth lost a child.
Yeah.
And that story's all about that.
Oh,
that
I did know that.
Blessed be the Lord in all my grief and all my pain.
Mm.
It's still blessed be the Lord.
Yeah.
And when the morning comes, I will still be blessing the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of, and that, it's a great song.
Yeah.
And then when you hear
what
comes behind you, it's even more. You think, when you're then in a, especially when you're somewhere like Big Church Out and he's singing it.
Yeah, right.
He's singing Blessed Be the Lord. You know the history behind it.
Yeah.
You're singing it with him and you've got tears coming down your eyes because you know where that song's come from.
Yeah.
You know the pain and the hurt and I love that about people that when they put their music to song like that and they talk about their grief.
Yeah.
And that waving through a window, what we've just done, he's talking about that grief. Matt Redman, Blessed be the Lord, he's talking about that grief.
Yeah.
And there's hundreds of them out there that will talk about that grief.
Yeah, right.
But we still look at the positive side of things. So I could name five or six Matt Redman that I really love.
Mm,
and we could do a Matt Redman playlist.
Yeah, a whole Matt Redman playlist, easily.
Yeah,
that song for me was just about... It was I want to say I was at New Wine, maybe, like a Christian family festival. I was young and it was that age of, it was on this album called Unleashed and I flipping loved it.
Yeah.
Never found it since, I bought it, lost it, bought a fall. Haven't found it since, and then remembered this song a few years ago and I was like, oh my gosh, because it was the first time I realised like a relationship with Jesus could be fun.
Yeah.
Because it talks about like, it's the overflow of a forgiven soul. And we're not going to be silent. We'll be a dancer generation because we'll dance with joy and we'll do it and we'll shout about it and it's incredible. And I went back to a church that was a bit more like sedated in worship and quiet and I was like, okay. And I was listening to something like, So why can't we be jumping and happy and dancing? Why can we be like singing Happy Days and be like mildly swaying? Like, this doesn't feel very happy. I feel like I'm singing words. And I kind of forgot about it for years. And then, you know, went through anxiety and all those things, and that developed and was very trapped and stuck in that. So when I came to freedom, and that whole part of me started, like, God started to unlock that part of me again of, like, actually, you can have joy in worship. Like, you can have joy in me no matter what. Like, it can express itself physically. Like, you don't have to be swaying to worship me. Like, just worship however you want to worship. If you want to dance, you should dance, because David danced before the Lord.
Yeah.
Like, why shouldn't you? Why can't you? And I just, I love that song in its simplicity and its form of just reminding me God is all about fun. God is all about joy. And actually, like, when you have a heart of joy, you just want to, like, dance and go a bit crazy because you're so happy. You just have that unexplainable peace.
Yeah.
That deep-rooted joy in Jesus. How does that not make you want to dance?
Yeah.
Like, how does that not make you want to have boogie? So I love that because of that. It's just, but yeah, all my Redman songs, absolute bangers. He's
yeah.
incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible worship leader. Oh, I do love him.
Matt's good. Mm. Matt's good. I got a feeling it won't be long before the Church of England start using some of his music. they've got to Graham Kendrick. They want Graham Kendrick these days.
Oh, dear.
How
did I get there?
Right, so almost. If they got to Graham Kendrick 50 years later...
surely it's about time. almost there.
It won't be long. It won't be long.
Bring it into the modern era of Matt Redman.
Yeah, yeah, but... I love Graham Kendrick. Just love that he had this heart to change music.
Yeah, exactly.
Change Christian music. I love that he had that heart. And we definitely will do, at some point, a Graham Kendrick playlist.
For sure.
Because we have to. Even if we're going to use other people's versions of what he's done.
That's fine.
I don't mind because...
Same words, different
channel. And big church last year,
yeah.
Graham Kendrick was there for his 50th or 60th year, however many it was.
Mm.
And just being in there, for most people that you know, I've seen Ren Collective, I've heard Philippa Hannah,
mm.
and a lot of people talk, and they are so thankful for what Graham Kendrick did,
yeah.
so that they can be where they are today,
sure.
because
yeah, exactly.
he paved
see,
the way.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and we listen to some of his songs now, and you think, they're not that upbeat and fast and dancey and bouncy.
No.
When you think of it, but when I first became a Christian, he was
yeah.
the one,
mm.
you know, him, Stuart Townsend, Chris Beauvoir, and they was the ones, and he's listening and bouncy,
like, oh.
And I'm listening to him thinking,
it's so tame.
It is quite tame, you know, Shine Jesus Shine. It's quite tame.
What a banger, but now it's
like, yeah, it is quite tame, really.
Yeah.
But then, it was a
yeah,
big
it was
thing,
revolutionary.
You know.
Yeah, for sure.
So, yeah. So, to go from Shine Jesus Shine to Jesus Freak.
Yeah.
It's a massive step.
Quite a big leap.
I think it's a go to Skillet. So, I think we're going to revisit childhood.
Okay. With what?
Teenage years.
Godless is such a great band. And they're not underrated, but... their old stuff is just...
Yeah, all music is sad.
All my penises.
Yeah, because it sounds just like waving through the window.
Right. And dancing through life.
Yeah.
Same vibe as Busted.
Yeah, it might be a bit in the same. It might be the same boat as Busted. It might be, yeah. Even for an old man, I'm having a spot to
it. I remember this song mainly because it's got a lot of like family ties, a lot of... There's this one moment specifically this song, I could not tell you why I remember it, but we were coming off the ferry in France And we were, it was coming into the night, and as we like broke, like you like kind of driving up, I don't know why, off the ferry, and like it should be kind of broke over the bridge, and like you like look down on the city. It was just like it suddenly broke into like the chorus, and it was just like this beautiful city of lights, and this song was like blaring in the car. We'd been on this really long travel. I just remember like sitting next to my brothers, my mum and dad, and we just like drove over this thing and just looking out in France and being like, oh my gosh, what a beautiful moment. I don't know why, it just really triggers that memory. But yeah, Coldplay, like Kasabian, Kooks, The Killers, all those kind of thing, the Fratellis, that's like my cousin brother influence of like music, and I still love those kind of bands. All those songs, just yeah. And then my cousin's really into music, my brother's quite into music, and again, you should grow up around it, you just love it. And Coldplay and those classic people that just really are real musicians, really can like play other instruments, really write their own lyrics, enjoy the music as well, have a real passion for it.
Mm.
All those kind of bands. Oh yeah, and it just reminds me of family holidays with my cousins and my brothers. Like my, obviously my parents and auntie and uncle are there, so I just mean my cousins, my brothers. But just so many of the memories, and like everything's all about like surrounded by music, and just so many different memories about holidays and accidents happening on holidays and fun things. And I just love a good old classic band. There's just nothing quite like that era of music. I just think songs are so different nowadays. Like, they just, like, really think about it. I feel like sometimes now people just throw music together with, like, auto-tune, and I'm like, eh, it's okay, but...
Yeah, yeah.
When you think about it, they could, like, really... They understood the music, they played the music, they cared about it. They took, like, 2 years to write albums rather than, like, 2 weeks. It's just, it just, yeah, hits a whole different kind of... It feels more satisfying to listen to that kind of music of that era.
And for me, you know the talented people when you start listening to some of the songs they wrote when they were so young, you know, and then you start hearing, so, you know, Gary Barlow, he wrote his first song that became a hit later on when he was 13 years old.
Did he?
You know, you think, whoa.
Gary Barlow.
Stevie Wonder, exactly the same. But actually he was writing songs when he was like 7, 8, 9 years old. But his first one, I think he was 11 or 12.
That's so crazy.
He never sang it himself. Smokey Robinson sang Tears of a Clown.
Yeah, yeah.
Such a famous song. No, Stevie Wonder wrote that when he was like 11 or 12 years old. You know, you think, whoa. Kate Bush, another one, 12, 13 years old. And you suddenly, when you learn these things, you suddenly start having more respect for those people.
Yeah.
Because even all those years later, they are still...
They're still going, yeah.
Having that, they still have that passion for that music.
Yeah.
And I was never a massive fan of Kate Bush growing up.
Yeah.
I thought she was a bit of a whino with her voice and everything. It had to be some. But as you learn these things about her, you start thinking, well, actually, I'm going to have a proper listen. And you become a little bit more mature and you listen to her. And wow.
Talented.
You know, this person was so talented at such a young age and not scared to use it. You know, and there's lots and lots of people out there that have wrote songs. And the amount of songs that that people are famous for, other people that were wrote for people that we don't know.
Yeah.
You know, the Bee Gees, however many hits they've had,
they've
nearly had that many hits from somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look, we sing along to songs that actually they wrote and we don't know that.
Yeah.
So it is. And I did all, because during COVID, as a family, we just did a family quiz, and I became host, so I did a lot of the... questions now. So I researched a lot of the music. So we had a music round. I did a lot of research around it, and I did a top ten. So I'd do a top ten. So we'd play the intro, and you had to try and guess the song. And I did 10 of people under the age of 16 that wrote songs.
Wow.
You know, and it is.
That's ridiculous.
And then after that, you start finding, oh, he did as well. Oh, and she did. And suddenly there's another 10 that you can do it again. It is quite amazing. And it's good when you get those that do write their own stuff and play their own stuff.
Yeah.
And the Barbarians album is going to be just like that.
Oh, my goodness.
Those people, those writers are all people that have wrote those songs within Freedom Church.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Chariot is out at the moment, and obviously tomorrow for us, but for these, Purify will be out, but the whole album will be out probably by the time this goes out. And that album
is incredible. And that's what makes it even more incredible, I think, is that it's written by
yeah
by people who have a talent, have given into it, have that passion, had that God-given ability to, like, feel an emotion, feel like a, I don't know if feel is the right word, but, like, to be able to express worship in a way that everyone can then participate in and worship. Oh, just... It's an incredible album. I can't wait.
And, we, and some of these people, we've listened to their stories. Mm-hmm. We've listened to the hard times they've gone through. And they come out writing songs like this, and you think, whoa.
It just hits on a whole new level.
It does. It does. Yeah. And you do invest in that sort of thing. You invest in that because, you know George, we know Dave, we know Sam, we know all these people. We've had conversations with them. We've been led by them. We've watched them crack up and get on their hands and knees because they're having a tough time. And we've seen all this. We've seen them in tears. And there they are writing and leading us in an album that is going to be absolutely amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be absolutely stunning.
It really is.
And it is. And it's just great to be part of it. Mm-hmm. It really is. So we're not far off the end. So
not far.
We are into... We're going into our ninth one.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going back to... We're going back to Christianity. You must remember your last Christian song that you put on.
Yes, thank you, wouldn't you? I've got your very words. Bad memory, Dave. Oh, no, yeah, doing this one.
Yeah. I must be a thousand songs written by Hillsong.
Right.
Feeling this song probably had a few tears to it, didn't it?
Oh, 100%. I mean, most things do these things.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely. But I mean, just listen to the lyrics.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just that, it's that song that, like, this year, especially the end of last year, start of this year, I listened to it and was like, I'd heard it a million times, and I really listened to it, and I just couldn't stop crying. More out of, like, gratitude to God and joy of, like, the fact that my whole journey of anxiety and this, that whole last year of, like, restoration and coming out of anxiety and dealing with not just that but so many different roots and triggers and family stuff, just the fact that God had loved my whole heart through that. And I was like, I can't believe that's what you protect, that's what you saw. Like, even when I was doubting, even when I was, like, angry at you, even when I just couldn't stand to be a Christian and I was so mad and I couldn't get it and I was wanting everything to be fixed and I was hurting so bad, God just loved me through that, and it blew my mind, it baffled me. And there's just a lyric when it talks about she just sung it. Well, yeah, it's like saying something about how she has, like, have more reasons now to sing than to fear, which I totally do. And again, later on, I think in the chorus or the bridge, she sings, look where my chains are now. Like, death has no hold on me because your grace holds me now. And it was just, listen to that after the year I'd been through, I was just baffled. I was like, what the absolute heck, Jesus? Like, look where my chains are. Like, I was so bound by such heavy chains from anxiety, but also just from, like, things people had said over me that I'd put on myself, these weights that I've been carrying. And I was like, I don't need to carry that anymore. I don't even need to think about it. And I just was crying out of gratitude and, like, joy and praise, being like, I can't believe you want to free me from that, learning the fact you actually did. And that throughout that whole thing, and there had been really dark times in my life, and I just couldn't go on, and I just didn't want to deal with anything. And I look back, and they're really scary because it came so close. But then I'm like, even in that, God, you love me. You love me solely. You love my whole heart through the entirety of that. And because of that journey, I'm who I am today and where I am now. And it's just, I listen to it now and I cry again because, you know, Jesus and me being emotional. Just cry with gratitude. I'm just so thankful. And I can't not hear it without just beaming and being like, this God that we serve that loves us, that's who he is. He is love. He loves first. We love because he first loved us. And it's just, when you think about that love and that purity and that weight that it has, like, to get you through anything, it still baffles me. Like, it just, I can't explain it enough. And then if you just simply just sit and listen to that song, I mean, yeah, I don't know how God ain't going to change your life through that, and how he's not going to touch you and be like, guys, I just love you. Like, just keep going. I'm so here for you. And yeah, I just think, it just feels like for me at the moment of what I've just been doing, where I'm going into now, just a season of such celebration and such testimony of God shattered my past. Like, I don't walk in that shadow anymore. I don't walk in that fear. I walk in complete freedom. And this song for me just exemplifies that season. And I flipping love it.
You touched on restoration there.
Mm.
And sometimes people will think that things are just random and thrown together.
Mm.
So you think of, again, Academy Plus 2022 team.
Yeah.
It looks like we was all thrown together just
so
randomly.
Random. Yeah.
But when you start looking at it, how many of us have gone through restoration?
Yeah, right.
All of us?
Mm-hmm.
12 out of 13, maybe?
Yeah, I say all. Yeah.
I think all 13 of us have gone through restoration
it's
of some form.
Yeah.
Some obviously have come from a lower place, maybe.
Or
but,
it's been more physical.
Yeah. But that restoration, you know, it is for all of us.
Mm.
And the year was about restoration.
Yeah,
it really was.
Yeah.
Although we learned lots of other things,
mm-hmm.
all of us have come out a lot more whole, a lot more restored, a lot more
right.
the people that God wants us to be.
Mm-hmm.
Without changing who we are.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the amazing thing, that I'm not a different person in one sense to what I was 30 years ago. However, I am restored to a person that God wants me to be, and I'm a wiser person, and I'm a better leader, and I pour out as much as I'm being poured into and things like that more now. And I'm in a place where I can walk through issues, I can walk through problems, and you're in exactly the same place.
Yeah,
that
right.
We move into 2023 with so much joy, so much gratitude, so much happiness from a place of absolute brokenness.
Yeah, right.
You know, and just seeing those journeys out. And we will come through later in of a podcast, because we'll get some of the Academy 2022 on here at times. And they will share such similar stories, because we've come through restoration as a group.
Yeah.
And so many bonds. And it is quite amazing how you think you're randomly put together, and then you start realising that actually God's got a theme here, you know, and it's nowhere near as random as it first looks, you know. And then you start hearing stories about some that are on this year, and I said, well, we were going to go on this year, but we decided not to. We thought we'd leave it here and go next year.
Yeah.
Where, well, I'm 3 months at the church. Do you want to go? I was thinking about Academy Plus, thought maybe it's too early.
Yeah.
Geoff says, you thought about Academy Plus, and that was the, okay, I'll come on Academy Plus.
Possibly.
Because I thought about it, I thought, oh, it's probably too early. Mm. So Geoff then got in touch, and I thought, oh, okay, maybe that's God saying, get on Academy Plus.
Yeah.
You know, and it's the perfect time to be on it.
Mm.
You know, and I love that restoration is there. I love to see that growth. And though that song that we've just gone through from Hillsong wouldn't be one that I would put to my restoration.
Yeah.
I can see why. The words are superb, absolutely beautiful.
Incredible.
Yeah, they are. And touching. And you can see why you'd have tears and that, because It's that emotional.
Mm. Yeah.
So we're on to the last but one.
Yes. Yes. Last of my choice, and there's your choice, right?
Yeah. And only this time, I don't always put my choice last. My choice will usually go in the middle. But you want to know why they're on the last one.
I do.
Yeah, you do. I know.
It's a good one to save, I must say.
That's the one I want.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think people know it?
Oh, 100%.
100%?
Well...
Do you know it?
Not really.
Maybe not then. I think a certain...
I agree, there's a certain thing. There are
my mum, for sure.
I don't know. He does know it. You know what it's from?
No, but I didn't know it. I thought it did.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my
days.
It's so good. Have you seen this film?
No. Not this, not the latest one.
No, this isn't the first one.
Oh, is it from the first one?
Yeah,
okay then.
I mean, they do use it in the latest one as
well. Yeah, yeah,
it's from the opening of the original.
So, yes, I am. Do I remember the song in it, though?
What, at the beginning?
I still don't remember.
Oh,
it.
It's so good.
So for those of you that don't know, I thought it was from the latest song, but it's Top Gun, Danger Zone, the theme, I assume it is.
It's actually a song, though. It's
by Kelly Loggins.
Mm, yeah.
Kenny, yeah.
Kenny Loggins. It's a real song, but from the original. I just love all things 80s. I don't know where it came from, but like, the way they dress, I love it. And I don't know what it is, I just love Top Gun. So when the new one came out, that was incredible. Love, like, Back to the Future, Footloose. Pretty sure Roger Rabbit is around that time. And I don't know why
Don't talk to me about that. Back to the Future is my favourite all-time
so good.
Film.
But all of these 80s films. And like, the music from it, which, like, obviously my mum was loving, because I was into the songs in the car, and she'd be like, how do you know this? And I was like, I mean, they did a cover on Glee, and then I found the original, and I really like it. and then so she was loving it. Wham! Oh, just 80s. I just think in that fashion, I'm all like bringing back, which I think is coming back. Not that I should have to be able to justify wearing what I want. it just seems like such a fun time. It's so colourful. It just feels so loud. And yeah, I mean, Tom Cruise, I just think he's incredible. I mean, just the same kind of acting, but I just really love it. And Top Gun was just something else. It's one of the things, spoiler coming if you've never seen it, but it's too late because it's been out for ages.
Since the 80s.
When, like, Goose's death still hits me, like, just random moments. We watched it for the first time actually on honeymoon, and like it was just such a shock, and it's so quick, it's just horrible. Every now and then I will just be like doing life, and I'll be like, oh, he's like, are you okay? And I'm like, I just remembered Goose is dead. And James was like, what do you mean Goose is dead? I'm like, from Top Gun. He's like, you mean like a fictional character? I'm like, yeah, but like the like emotion just like re-hit me because it was just such a tough death.
We've lost the camera.
Has he?
It's out of storage.
Ah, okay then.
What I might do is quickly, I think I'm going to copy over. You can carry on.
Okay.
We'll just have to go.
Yeah, we'll just have to go with the two.
I'll have to do some clever editing.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's clever anyway, so I'm alright. Pretend he's not, but he is. Yeah, so.
All things 80s is just. Yeah. I love it. I didn't live through it, sadly. But I love the clothes, I love the films, and I think. Just even how the films are shot, like, there's just something so classic about it. Like, because you watch the new Top Gun, it's great, it's fine, it's quite nice how it ties into the old one, but I just love the classic look of the old films and how they're made, and they seem to, like, there wasn't much CGI, and they had to kind of create everything, so it's more real, where everything now is so CGI, I'm like, that's okay. It's not very impressive.
Apart from Jaws.
But that's a classic for it itself. That's so good. So good. I mean, it's not good when you love, but like, it's incredible for what it was.
So, obviously, I was very young, so I think 78 might have been the first Jaws. And my dad took me and my brothers to see it. And it's scary. At 8, 9, 10 years old, seeing this big shark coming out trying to eat someone, you see half a body beat at half.
It's not nice.
And when you start thinking about it, it looked so real then. And actually, when you see the body now, it's actually still quite good.
It's not bad, for what it
is. It's just
time,
the shark don't look like a shark. Yeah. It looks like something you play with in the bath.
But at the time, why I liked it, because at the time it was incredible and they were so inventive.
Yeah.
Now I just think we rely so much on CGI.
Yeah,
it's not even... Like, I mean, you look at things like Avatar... Like, I just love movies. I think it's incredible. We know things about Avatar. That's incredible, and that is all CGI, and that's all cleverly created. But I think that works, because from the beginning, that's how it was introduced to us. Was when you kind of got people... When you've got films starting, like, to add it into their films, and instead of creating props, instead of creating atmosphere with physical things... It then just kind of adds, it all just makes you think, like, you're not really trying, you're being a bit pathetic, you're trying to add it in there. And I think just sometimes it's overused, it doesn't really work. But I love all things 80s, not sure why, but I do.
I love all things 80s as well.
Think I was born around, 80s, right, or 1920s, like, take me back to when I can be, in Downton Abbey, and be, like, Lady Mary Crawley, I'd be that, or I'd live in the 80s, born in the wrong era.
You don't want to be Miss Bennet.
Because they don't have, like... I mean, she's feisty, she's got all that going on, but, like, she doesn't live the life, I want the servants. I want the elegance. I want to dress for dinner. I want to go down and have breakfast made.
You don't want to marry Mr. Darcy?
No, I'm not a fan.
No,
I mean,
no.
I love the book, it's incredible, but I want Mr. Crawley, yeah. I like Matthew.
Oh, not even Mr. Bingley.
Oh man, they are incredible, but I do like them. Period dramas I love. If I could be anything, I'd be in a period drama. That would be my favourite. People still put so much effort into things. Like, why don't we put effort into building houses anymore? Or clothes? Like, they would change 3-4 times. They just change to go riding. I think I'd take the same outfit all day. Whereas they get changed to go downstairs and do a day, and then get changed to go to London, and then get changed to go riding, change for dinner. I should change more in my life.
And when you think something like that, a highlight of the day is to take a turn.
Take a turn about the living room. Take a turn. Just walk around the chairs. I love it. Or they'll just sit and read for hours, and that's what you did this afternoon. I just sit and did some sewing.
Yeah.
Went for a walk in my garden. It was funny. James and I went to Barrington Hall the other week. And we walked down.
No, you took a turn down.
We did. Well, yeah, we were walking down this path with all these bushes, and the hall was there. And I was like, "So, Mr. Griffin, tell me more about yourself." Because I was like, "I just feel so down to Abby." It's like, "Don't look at me." I was like, "Oh, my wrist is out. I'm exposed." I love the classic times, and everything was so simple and so beautiful and so innocent. Oh, I love that too. Yeah, if I could be anything, it'd be a Downton, be a period drama. That was funny. Poor James was just like, "What are you doing?" And I was like, "Being dramatic. What do you mean, what am I doing?" Funny.
So being creative, being creative, and would you agree with the saying that there's a book in everyone?
A book as in anyone could write a book?
Well, I'm assuming a classic, I'd imagine they mean.
I don't think I've heard the phrase before.
Have you not heard that everybody's got a book in them?
No.
No. Well, there's a saying out there. Maybe I've made it up. There's a saying out. Say again. Like Penny's Hat. Maybe I've just made it up. But they say there's a book in it. Maybe it's because I think there's a book in me, and I want everybody to think there's a book in everyone, so I don't feel weird.
If you're thinking about writing a book, for sure, we've all got enough experiences and, life experience, surely, to write one.
I think I've got a musical in me, to be fair.
I
really do think I've got a musical in me. And it's just getting that confidence in myself to think, okay, shall I sit down and I start writing the characters and start writing it? And it's something that I have thought about. But again, we've done Academy Plus, and you're getting to a place where you think, okay, let's not be scared of it, let's not be frightened.
Just do
so
it.
This podcast, I've thought about it for a couple of years now.
Yeah.
You know, I've thought about it and things like that. Yeah. And I, even in a couple of areas, I sort of tested it because I sat in, I can't even remember what the group was, and I just said, so we were just chatting there, and I said, can anybody remember sort of the first song, the first Christian song that they really got into? And they said, I said, well, mine is Jesus Freak, so I went through it and give them a little bit. And then they all started opening up. Sure. And I thought, it will work. It's going to work. Are you waiting to tell me something?
No, I thought I'm
okay.
I was waiting.
But
the maneuver of that.
Yeah, so with that, I thought, right, well, so I put the ideas to Caleb. He said, we should do that.
Yeah.
So
here we are.
Waited for Academy Plus to finish. I thought, right, we'll get that in. See if people are up for it. And people are saying, I'll do it. So here we are.
Here we are.
Smash. Though this is our second recording, you will be episode one.
No pressure.
So, and obviously, as you know, we're coming to the final song. The final song is my song for you.
Okay.
Which is what I will do with everyone. It'll be my song for them. And this could nearly be for James. It can be for you.
Mm-hmm.
It could probably be for a lot of people.
I can't wait to hear explanation.
I'm going to read a few words first.
Good.
So the song is a bit like a conversation between Philippa Hannah, who's the songwriter and singer, and God. And Philippa Hannah's thoughts and God.
Yeah.
And it is. So this is like God answering her. It makes me sad when I hear you say you wish you were, that you were stitched some other way. So that you were stitched some other way. So at the moment, he's talking to her as if she's the raggedy doll.
Yeah.
Because you don't look like the other toys, and you're not the same as them, but I want to take you down from the shelf and show you off, and I want to love you until you love yourself. And then she goes, and then the chorus comes on, because you're beautifully and wonderfully made. I don't make mistakes, and I wouldn't change a thing. And that's God saying to you, not calling you a raggedy doll.
No,
he says, imagine the way you are.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine the way that you are. He thinks you're beautiful. He thinks you're wonderful. And he doesn't make mistakes.
Yeah.
And it could be for you. Mm-hmm. It could be for James.
So
it's definitely for me.
Yeah.
You know? And then in it says, if you see me upside down, pick me up. Turn me around.
Nice.
And that's sort of what, for all of us,
yeah.
If I see you upside down, I should pick you up, turn you around, and say, let's get on with it.
Yeah.
And walk through with it. And that's what it's all about. It is. And for me, a raggedy doll is like a comfort blanket.
Sure, yeah.
And that sort of thing. It doesn't matter how scruffy it looks sometimes, or how ugly it is, because we love it.
Yeah.
And that's how God sees us. Doesn't matter how scruffy we are sometimes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Doesn't matter that we don't quite pray right, or we don't quite say the scripture quite right, or we don't do this quite right.
Mm.
Actually, it's not about how right we do it. It's actually about our heart and why we do it. And if we learn to love ourselves the way God loves us, we'll be more special.
Yeah, so true.
And this song, Raggedy Doll, so reminds me of you for that reason, that you had that no confidence, you had the anxieties you had, and to some extent I could just see that you were saying to God, I don't like the way you've put that button there, I don't like this about me, I don't 100%. Like the way I am, I don't like that, I don't. And God's saying, yeah, but I made you.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I made you.
Yeah.
It hurts me to think that you don't like what I've made. I don't make mistakes.
Mm.
I don't make mistakes.
Yeah.
And that's, then you say, you're beautiful, you're wonderfully made.
Mm-hmm.
I don't make mistakes. And you were in that position where you realise God doesn't make mistakes.
Nope.
And he loves you from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet.
Mm-hmm.
And he loves you because that's how he made you. That's how he wants
so
you to
true.
Be. And he wants you getting out there being as creative, as loud, as amazing as you are. And at times when you need to be quiet, and sit down and being alone, that's how he made you because it's who he wants you to be.
Yeah.
And that's how he wants you to be for James. That's how he wants you to be for the baby. That's how he wants you to be for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And to have seen your journey is amazing. And we are going to listen to this song. And I think we're probably going to listen to it all the way through. It's not the longest of songs. But
it's a good one.
It is a good one. And Philippa Hannah, I'm not really into country and western too much.
Mm-hmm.
But I saw her at the big church day out and she had such a beautiful voice. But you hear her story around it as well. And it reminds me of you as well because she's gone through mental health battles herself.
Just because you're mine, and I could paint your face in a million ways, with cherry lips so that you could taste all the sweet kisses I could pull your way each and every day. Cause you are beautifully and wonderfully made. I don't make mistakes and I wouldn't change a thing. I loved you from the day I brought you home. I loved you since the day that you were sown. Every stitch, every single view is just how I dreamed of you. So I want the whole world to know. I love you from your head down to your toes. I love you from your head down to your toes. Miraculous doll. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Miraculous doll. Whoa, whoa. It makes me sad when I hear you say, you wish that you were stitched on my way. Cause you don't look like the other toys, and you're not new anymore. I wanna take you down the nursery shelf and show you love till you love yourself. If you lose a battle, I will give you mine, just because you're mine. And you are beautifully and wonderfully made. I don't make mistakes and I wouldn't change a thing. I love you from the day I brought you home. I love you since the day that you were sown. Every stitch, every single view is just how I dreamed of you. And so I want the whole wild world to know. I love you from the head down to your toes. I love you from the head down to your toes. Miraculous doll. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Miraculous doll. Whoa, whoa. Sticks and stones may knock me down. May
And that is a beautiful song. It's a beautiful place to end our conversation.
Yeah.
Esther, so grateful for you to come along to share with us, share some really special moments, some things that, you know, we've touched on mental health, which to some extent I wasn't expecting to go to, but it is good because people out there need to hear that. To hear some of the laughs and some of the fun that you've had, you know, to have us laughing and that is brilliant, and it just shows you. Your music shows who you are. Just sitting here just shows who you are, the person God made you to be, and it's a beautiful person that God made you to be. And it's so wonderful to have shared some of your life with you and to see your journey. And I'm excited to see how it pans out in the future. Sadly, I'm not going to be here to see it all the way to the end because I'm pretty sure I'm not going to outlive you.
Oh, that's a nice positive
ending. But we will meet in heaven in the end, and we'll discuss it all then.
Can't wait.
Will celebrate together that we saw different parts of each other's journey to all the way to victory, all the way to the final destination, which is where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for that. I'm going to go sign James up for a date soon, so we can
should do that. He'll be the interesting one.
Get his, and then we'll sign you up for a celebration, short version of both of you.
Short version.
We'll talk.
Short couple version.
We'll do, we will, because it's the start of your relationship. So we'll only do it like a five songs thing.
Sure.
The five song thing, because in 10, 15 years' time, when we're having to come out to Cambodia to meet you.
Sure,
and
all the kids,
yeah. And obviously, if we go to the prophecy from
There's going to be a lot of kids.
And it may not all be yours, but we're going to come to that church hall where there's 250 kids
there.
We'll
be having an absolute party every week.
Exactly. Yeah. We'll do a couples one there. We might have to do 250 songs if you've got 250 kids in there.
Thank you so much for being part of this. It's been brilliant.
And I'm sure we'll get some great responses and that.
Yeah.
And if there's one person that finds salvation through this, it'd be brilliant.
Amen.
So thank you very much, Esther. James, thank you for your time.
Yeah.
And we need to get a date for you.
Yeah. Do I have to do the clap thing now?
No, I have to clap to finish.
That's what
she asked. Oh, which is similar.
Yeah, that's why we're all been on the same group.
Pokemon
name
did you do?
He's had a kid.
Who made it?
Yeah, and then looking at things I need to buy.
Like cart.
Combination score.
All those bottles, the microwave thing that the bottles go in.
Not for the baby day, for his work. He's not thinking about a baby. So you might flip
the work. Blue or yellow or baby pink.
Oh,
well, we're not allowed to paint anything.
Are we having one or two or three?
I'm having one.
We're having one now, but I thought
are there
three natural?
Three natural adoption.
Are there pairs in the family? Are there twins in the family?
No, twins
are.
I've done. My gramps has twin sisters, but that's the only twin. My side. But very unlikely. And then we still one heartbeat, so we're only one in there this time.
Yeah, it might be hiding, though. Might be hiding.
Stop it. Don't speak that over me. Thanks for having us.
That's all right.
And for pizza.
That's fine. Mm-hmm. It's been wonderful.
You got what you wanted?
We have.
For the first
place. Yes. I believe so.
We need a date from you.
Yeah, my friend's dead, so she's my calendar.
Okay, then. So... Any Thursday at the moment?
Just check my actual calendar.
We're off to... Is it Sunday the 19th? No, not this Sunday, it's Sunday after. It's the 12th this week, isn't it?
Mm.
The 19th we're off to Birmingham to do Ben and John from Five Starters Birmingham. Yes. So.
Thursdays, hold on. Can I get back to you?
Are you playing with that? Yeah, get...
Yeah, I'm still playing with
that. It's looking a lot more full than I anticipated. Is it
going
to get worse? I mean, better.
It's going to
get better. Yes. Just keep reminding me
and
I'll get back to you.
Okay, yeah. Thank you very much for sharing.
Thanks, Dad.
Absolutely superb.
It's great
idea,
Dave.
It is. It's going to work. I know people are always saying, when's it coming out? Because I want to be listening to it in my car all the way down to wherever or all the way up to somewhere.
Going to begin. There you go. Right one.
You have to open both. Yeah, you have to use both.